Hello students, hope you are doing well. So right now you are in class 9 and we are going to study IT 402, a new subject introduced by CBSC to enhance skill development among individuals. Using this course, you will be skilled enough to work as a data entry operator in an office. You are capable of handling all the activities there that is being performed in an office. In this course, there are many various things that you need to know, various new concepts which are being introduced. The things which are already there in your book earlier, which you have already been taught in your previous classes. Today, we are going to focus on that only, and we will discuss a little about what are the new things that you are going to read, study in this year. So, moving forward, we will take a look on the basics of computer. As you all reading about, listening about, studying about computers, you are already knowing that it's an electronic machine. It's an electronic device which is capable of processing data. The data which is being entered or inputted by the user, given by the user, the computer processes it and generates the desired output. I have used the desired word because the output is as per the requirement of the user, but not as the computer wants or desires, but it is upon the need or desire of the user. So you have to put an emphasis on that word, that it generates the desired output. It means whatever we want, that output will be generated. Suppose you want to add two different numbers and you want to get the result of that. In that case, if the computer gives it in the form of binary, as you all are knowing that computer performs everything in the form of binary. It accepts data in the form of binary, it processes it in the form of binary. Anything that is stored in a computer is in the form of binary numbers. Suppose the computer gives the sum of those two numbers in the form of binary, then that doesn't solve your purpose. You don't want in that form. The form you want, that is the desired form. That is the desired output you are needing. So, moving forward, you could see here in your screen, a computer is an electronic machine which converts data into meaningful information. Meaningful information means it should have some meaning for us. Suppose the example I have given you few seconds ago, that I am giving two different numbers and it should generate the sum of that two numbers. In that case, suppose the computer is not generating it in English or Hindi, it is generating the output in some other language, then that doesn't make any meaning to us. It is meaningless for us. So the computer is a machine which converts data into meaningful information so that we can use that data for further benefits. A computer is basically divided into three different processes or three different parts. It basically takes the data, processes it. How it processes? It converts the data into information. After processing, the way of processing is converting it into process information. How? By creating different combination of that data. Different combination of that data can, or different manipulation of that data can create, make it a information. After that, it is made meaningful so that the user can understand it. I am giving one example. Suppose you have entered two different numbers to know its sum, then that two numbers are called the input data. Then at the time of processing, what it does, it converts those two digits into binary numbers, calculates its sum, and once the sum is obtained, that is the result. But that sum is in the form of binary numbers. It doesn't make any sense for us. So further, the computer converts that binary numbers into meaningful information. How? By converting into a decimal number. Now we know that what is the answer of those two numbers, what is the sum of those two numbers. So this is a basic symbolic representation of a computer system, which you are already aware of. Further, moving forward, we will discuss about the two different aspects or two different parts or two different things which a computer is made up of, that is software and hardware. Firstly, we will talk about hardware. As you are all knowing this, hardware are those parts of the computer system which we can touch and see, the physical components which can be easily seen, which can be touched. We can easily see it while we are using a computer system. Suppose as soon as we reach near a computer system, we see a monitor. That monitor is a hardware. We use the keyboard to type something. That keyboard is a hardware. We use a mouse to give some input to the computer system. That mouse is a hardware. So all the devices that we see when we are using a computer system are the hardware devices. So here you can see at the bottom that a computer hardware is the one we can see and touch. It's quite easy. You can understand in this way that whatever device or whatever thing related to a computer which we can see and touch are called computer hardwares. It's quite easy. Moving forward, the computer hardware is basically divided into three main units. You are already aware of these things, but I am giving you a short summary so that you can understand in a better way that what we are going to learn in this year. This is also included in your syllabus. The three main units or parts a computer is divided, that is the hardware parts of the computer system, they are classified into three different units. Those units are the input unit, the processing unit, and the output unit. The input unit consists of all the input devices. The input unit comprises of all the input devices. The input devices are those devices which are used to give input to the computer system. We give input to the computer system using these devices. Suppose right now I am using a laptop to interact with you people. You are also using some kind of computer device. Maybe it's a smartphone, maybe it's a laptop, maybe it's a desktop. Even the smartphones are also capable of doing whatever a computer can do. So you can treat your smartphone as a computer system. So all the things which we can use to give instruction to the computer system can be treated as the input devices. You are using a smartphone. By what means you are giving instruction to that smartphone to open YouTube or some other apps, or you want to type something, how you are doing that? Using that touch screen. So you can say that touch screen is the input device. Right now I am using the mouse and keyboard to interact with you people. That keyboard and mouse are examples of input devices. Further, we can talk about other devices such as scanner. Scanner is an input device which is used to convert hard copy form of a paper into soft copy. It means whatever is written in a computer system, in a paper, if you want to convert it and make it a soft copy or an electronic form of that paper, you can scan it using some scanner. Then it will be converted into electronic form, which you can store it in some pen drive or computer or any memory device. Moving forward, we have light pen. Light pen is a kind of a input device which is used to give input to the computer system. You might have been watching cricket for a long time. You might have seen that during a cricket match, the commentators used to point out that this player should be moved from this place to some other place. In this way, suppose if I am doing this, then it should be like this. They are using some kind of pointer. And what they are doing, they are marking like this, that this player should be moved from this place to this place. So in a cricket match, this is being done using a light pen. This is being done by a light pen. You can use light pen to give instruction to the computer system. Further, moving forward, we have joystick. A joystick is a input device which is used to give input by moving a jack-like thing. You can say that joystick are also used to play games also. In some playing zones where we have game zones in malls, you can use those joystick to play games. It is some kind of jack which you can move like this and this, so that your vehicle can move forward or backward in this way. You can use that pointer or that jack in this way, so that it is something like the gear of a vehicle. We have gears in four-wheelers. It is something like that, which can be used to give input to the computer system, so that the cursor or the thing which we want to control can move forward or backward or left or right. It can make you feel realistic. So they are used in that way. Further, we have magnetic tapes, magnetic tape and magnetic disc. These are the things which are used to give input to the computer system. Further, moving forward, we have the central processing unit, that is the CPU, which is the processing unit of our computer system. The CPU consists of three main units, that is the ALU, arithmetical logical unit, CU, control unit, and MU, that is the memory unit. ALU is that part of the CPU which is capable of processing arithmetic as well as logical operations. Arithmetic operations are those operations in which general mathematics is involved. General arithmetic, which you have studied in mathematics, such as addition, subtraction, multiplication, division. These are the arithmetic things which you have learnt in mathematics. The ALU part is capable of performing those operations. Further, it can also perform logical operation. Logical operation is like comparing things. How you can say that some number is bigger and some number is smaller by comparing it. That kind of comparison, whose output can be true or false, or whose answer can be obtained as yes or no, can be called as logical operations. Those operations whose answer can be true or false, otherwise that answer can be yes or no, those kind of operations are called logical operation. So a computer is capable of performing logical operation also. Further, is there any device which can do a same kind of thing? Yes, we have calculator who can perform arithmetic operation. But can it perform logical operation also? No. It is not capable of performing logical operation. It can perform only arithmetic calculations, simply. So this is the basic difference between a computer and a calculator. This is the basic difference. In calculator, we have input unit, we have output unit, we have memory unit, we have processing unit. But what we don't have, that is the logical unit, that part of the ALU who is responsible of performing logical operations. That is not present in a calculator. So this is the gap, or this is the difference between a computer and a calculator. So moving forward, we have control unit. Control unit is that part of the computer system who is responsible of controlling whole of the computer system. This control unit manages everything. As soon as you switch on the computer system, as soon as you power on the, you press the power button of your CPU and your computer starts booting, the control unit gets activated. It controls the overall functioning of the computer system. It gives instruction where the data should start flowing and where it has to reach. The overall operation is being managed by the control unit. Whenever we press any button from the keyboard, the data has reached the processor for processing or not, that is being acknowledged by the control unit. We are giving input from the mouse. That input is being received by the processor or not, that is being acknowledged by the control unit. When we switch on the computer system, the control unit checks whether all the devices are connected properly or not. If all the required or important devices are connected properly, then only the booting process will proceed forward. Otherwise, it will stop immediately and it will tell us that your computer has this problem, so we can't proceed. We have to stop the booting process. Mouse is not connected properly, or the keyboard is not connected properly, or the RAM is not connected properly, or the hard disk is not connected properly. These are the essential devices. Without these devices, the computer can't complete the process of booting. So it generates a understandable error in this way and stops the booting process. So we can say that the control unit is responsible of managing everything that is being performed in a computer. It is responsible of handling everything. It assists the user. It assists the user to use a computer system. Now moving forward, we have the memory unit. The memory unit is comprising of the memory devices. Memory devices? Yes, memory is something which is required to store something. Whatever files or data you want to store in a computer system will be kept at a location which is known as memory. You store some songs, you store some movie, some file, some picture, or anything which is in electronic form, that will be kept in memory. You might be knowing that you have some microchip, some memory chip in your mobile phone, which is required to store some files, which defines that how many data you can store in your mobile. That memory chip is one kind of memory, which is used to store files. Whatever photo, whatever video you record using your smartphone are kept in that memory device. Same kind of thing is there in computer also. The computer has a hard disk, computer has a RAM, computer has pen drives, CDs. So there is a classification between them. The computer memory is divided into two parts, primary memory and secondary memory. Primary memory is that part, that type of memory which is required by the computer system. That type of memory is not required by us, but it is required by the computer system. The computer system requires it. How? We have two primary memories, RAM and ROM. Whereas, in case of secondary memory, we have too many secondary memory devices. We have, you might be knowing pen drive, you might be knowing hard disk, CD, DVD, memory card, and many more other memory devices. So, what is the difference between them? Why two types? What is the use of using two different types of memory? Does the mobile phone also have two types of memory? We will discuss on that. First of all, know what is the difference between primary memory and secondary memory. Primary memory is that type of memory which is required by the computer system for its functioning, for its storage of data. When the computer processes something, it needs the data for processing. So when it accepts the data, it has to keep that data somewhere. So whatever memory is used by the computer at the time of processing is known as the primary memory. And that memory is RAM. RAM is that memory which stores the data at the time of processing. Suppose in your computer system, you have double clicked a music file, a MP3 file. As soon as you double click it, it starts playing. What happens at that time? That MP3 file is being copied from the hard disk to RAM. And once it is copied over there in RAM, the processor reads it from the RAM and plays it as per your instruction. So why it copies data from hard disk to RAM? Because RAM is a very faster memory. As we know that a computer processor is a very fast processor which can process data very fast. So we measure the speed of a processor in the form of million instructions per second. How many instruction it can process, how many million of instruction it can process in 1 second. So we can say that a computer can process millions of instruction in 1 second. So its speed is measured in the form of MIPS. The speed of a processor is measured in the terms of, in the unit of MIPS, that is million instructions per second. So if a computer can process million instruction, he needs someone to give that data, that much amount of data within a second. It means it needs a faster memory. So hard disk is not that much amount of faster as compared to RAM. RAMs are very fast. So computer needs a RAM to store that intermediate data which is just to be processed, which just needs to be processed. So we can say that RAM is a very fast memory which can work along with the processor for quick processing of the data, so that the user can think that the processing is being done in real time, right? This is the reason that RAMs are very expensive. If you go to the market and inquire on that, you can get that 1 GB hard disk, the cost of 1 GB hard disk and cost of 1 GB RAM. 1 GB hard disk is quite cheaper, and so computer manufacturers don't manufacture that amount of memory because it's very less and also it's very cheap, around few rupees So why a computer company, why a manufacturing company manufacture that small amount of data, memory? So it manufactures around 500 GB or 1 TB of hard disk, because the cost of 500 GB or 1 TB of hard disk is equal to the price of 2 or 3 GB of RAM. 2 GB of RAM and 1 TB of hard disk, equal price. It means that a small amount of RAM is capable of doing what a 1 TB means, much bigger, 500 times. 500 into 2 is around 1000, that is 1 TB is equal to 1024 GB, 1024 GB, and here it is 2 GB. So 1024 GB and 2 GB, 1024 GB of hard disk, 2 GB of RAM, both are of equal price. So it's very fast, the RAM is very fast, that's why, that is the reason behind that. So we have to pay more for purchasing a RAM. So this is the overall work a RAM performs. It works synchronizingly with the processor, so that it can process data at the real time, at the same time, so that the user thinks that it is not making any delay. As soon as, suppose you are going to add two different numbers, as soon as you press the equal button, the answer is generated within milliseconds or nanoseconds, not even a second. It doesn't take a second. It generates the output within some millisecond or nanosecond. It means it is much faster than your pressing of equal button. So in this way, proceeding forward, we can now discuss about ROM. ROM is the memory, that is read-only memory, is a memory which we can read only. We can only read, we can't write anything on it. Whereas the RAM is random access memory, that is, it is accessed randomly. Randomly by whom? Who accesses this memory? The processor. The processor accesses this memory randomly. So it has to be fast, because it has to interact with a high speed device such as a processor, and randomly also. So a RAM has to be faster. Comparing RAM and ROM, RAM is a volatile memory. It means it cannot store anything permanently. As soon as you switch off your computer system, anything that is stored in your RAM is deleted automatically, and the RAM is made blank. You can't store anything in that. But a ROM is a permanent memory. Anything that is stored in it remains permanent. Even you can't delete it. Only the manufacturer can delete it. Few RAMs are there which cannot be erased. Some are there which can be erased or programmed accordingly. Why the ROMs are made in that way, that it cannot be erased? Data is stored in it. Why should not we erase it? Is there any requirement that we should erase our ROM? No. ROMs are those memory devices which stores the booting process, the files required to boot a computer system. So, suppose the manufacturer makes the ROM writable, then what will happen? As soon as it becomes writable, any virus can write anything in that, and it can change its instructions. So what will happen? When you start booting your computer system, it won't boot. It will stop booting. Why? Because you asked that virus to change those instructions by making it writable. So the manufacturer don't makes writable ROMs. You cannot write anything in it. Once the instructions are written by the manufacturer, it's permanent. It cannot be erased. Now, moving forward, this is the main use of ROM, nothing else. It is not used, not of any use to us. We don't need any ROM to transfer any movie or file to our friend. We don't need the RAM to store some PPTs and PDF and give it to our class teacher or our subject teacher for submission. Have you seen anybody that somebody has bought 1 GB of RAM and has placed some files in it and is giving it to its subject teacher? Sir, my project is ready. Take this RAM. Those are not handy and those cannot transmit file in that way. Those are temporary memory, which versatile memory, which cannot store any data permanently. The same case is with ROM also. Anything that is written in it is permanent. You can't erase it. You can't make it blank. You cannot store any data in it. So those cannot be used in that way. For that purpose, we have secondary memories, which is for the use of the computer user, not for the computer system. The computer system don't want those devices. That is for our use. What are those devices? Those are hard disk, pen drive, CD, DVD, memory stick, memory chip, the SD cards. Those are the devices which are used to store data and can be transferred from one place to another. We make use of the pen drive so often. Those are so handy that we can transfer file from here, from one computer to another quite easily. Those are the secondary devices, secondary memory devices. Now, moving back to our syllabus, the last unit is the output unit. The output unit comprises of all the output devices which are used to generate the output which a user wants. Suppose I want to add two different numbers and I don't want it to be displayed on the monitor. I want it to be told to us. We want to hear the answer. We don't want it to be displayed over the screen. In that case, our desire is to be told by the computer system. So in that case, the computer system will use the speaker as an output device to generate that output. So whatever device is used by the computer system to generate the output are called the output devices. Suppose I don't want the answer to be printed. I don't want it to be told to us in the form of sound. I don't want it to be played as a sound. I want it to be printed. So the computer will do what? It will print it using a printer. So we can say that a printer is the output device. So whatever device which are used to generate the output are called output devices. In this class, what you have to do, you have to create some notes on these things. What are the input devices? How they work? What are the output devices? How they work? What is the CPU? How it works? What are its three different units? What are their roles in the overall functioning of the computer system? What are the different memory devices? Classification of those devices. You have to prepare a complete notes on that. I will try to share some file with you people over the WhatsApp group. I think that will be beneficial for you people. You have to prepare two different copies. One for your classwork and one for your project work. That will be a practical copy, where you have to maintain the records of whatever you are performing in your practical class, in your lab. Whatever activity you perform in your computer lab, you have to maintain all those records in your practical copy for final submission. Okay, so that's all for today. From the next day onward, we will get into the details of this course. We will discuss about many new things. Entrepreneurs, IT enabled services, green skill, and many more new things. IT enabled services are those services which are given using the technology, that is IT, information technology. That thing which is given, those services which are given using the information technology, IT. Suppose we have Swiggy, Zomato, These are the services which are given to us using information technology. So these are called IT enabled services, BPOs, call centers. They are providing us troubleshooting of things. Suppose you have got some problem in your mobile phone. Your mobile phone is not working properly, or your Jio SIM is not working properly, or suppose your TV is not working properly. What you will do? You will call the customer care. The customer care is a BPO where they will receive your call and they will assist you to troubleshoot your problem. So this is one kind of IT enabled service. Information technology that enables the business by improving the quality of service is ITS. How a business implement information technology to improve its quality is called ITS. Now the company don't have to go to your house to troubleshoot the thing. They can do it manually by assisting you over phone. If there is some problem which cannot be resolved over phone, in that case, that engineer of that company will visit your home at your convenience. Understood? So these are called ITS. Swiggy, they are delivering food, but how can they know who is of need what thing, who is demanding anything? How can they know about the needs of a customer? So they have created some apps, Android apps. Now you can use those apps to request those companies that deliver me some kind of dish from that restaurant. Now the company is receiving your request, they are processing it and calling the respective person to ship it to your house. So now they have improved their way of doing business using information technology. That kind of thing is known as IT enabled service, where the businesses where information technology is being used to improve its quality are called IT enabled services. In the same way, we have a topic in our syllabus called entrepreneur. Entrepreneur, it's a French word which is used for those business persons, those individuals who brings a new concept of business. Those individuals who creates a new concept of business. Earlier, we are not knowing about Swiggy and Zomato. This is a new kind of concept of doing business. Earlier, we used to visit some restaurant to bring whatever is required in our house. Whatever is required, what dish is required in our house. We used to go that in that restaurant and we used to bring it on our own. But now, that process is outsourced by some company. So it's a new concept, a new kind of a business. So we can say that individual who has created Zomato or Swiggy is an entrepreneur. But there are some things which are to be taken care of. They have to bear maximum risk. There might be a situation that kind of a new business might not run. Not every business runs successfully from the first day. They have to bear that risk. And the benefit is they will be enjoying most of the rewards, because they have created that business. Paytm, which is one of the most successful IT company right now and is working with many new things, many new features. They are also working as a bank now. The person who created Paytm can be called as an entrepreneur. An entrepreneur can be seen as an innovator who bring in some innovation a new thing which is not there in the market earlier. He will be an innovator. He must have new ideas. He must know what is not there in the market, but it is in need. You might be knowing about OYO rooms, company who is taking care of all the hotels and transportation. Wherever you want to go, you can go easily and you can book a hotel from your home only. You don't have to visit that hotel to book a room. Now you can book it from the convenience of your house. That's a new kind of a business, a new idea. That is known as, that person who has developed this idea can be called as an entrepreneur. So not only ideas, it can be a new kind of a good, it can be a new kind of service, it can be a new kind of business, whatever. It should be innovative. So that kind of individual can be called as an entrepreneur. So we will discuss about these things in the later classes. For today, it's enough, I think. If you need any kind of assistance further, you can message me in my WhatsApp number. It's already been shared through your class teacher. I want to know your feedback. Whatever changes you want in this video, suppose you want to have some innovative things, you want to make it live, you want to interact at the real time, whatever things you want, you can give your feedback in my WhatsApp number or in your school group. Thank you everyone for watching this video. Please subscribe the channel so that I can provide you everything required. You can get all the required videos of your class in my channel only. You don't have to move here and there. You don't have to search over internet. Just subscribe the channel so that you can get all the things at a single place only. Okay. I will share the link with you all people. Thank you everyone. From the next day, please read the book which is already being shared in the WhatsApp group. And we will proceed forward then. Okay. Thank you. Have a nice day.